This is Dawna Lee Heising for More Horror, and today I'm so excited. We have as our special guest Vida Ghaffari, and she's one of the stars of the upcoming Circus of Dread from Mark Savage, which stars Bill Oberst Jr. and Domiziano Arcangeli. So I'm so excited to finally meet you in person.
Me too. I'm so excited to meet you, and thank you so much for inviting me on your show. It truly is an honor, but you have to add that you're one of the stars of Circus of Dread as well.
Well, I'm in the circus. I don't know what my role is yet, but I'm really excited to be working with Vida. Aww. Okay, now let's start at the beginning. I know you're from Washington. Tell me about your family.
You know, it's very interesting. I have a very quirky family. My dad's a scientist, and my mom is very artistic. She was an illustrator in the old country. She was actually a child actress in Iran, and she performed, this is before things got crazy there. Oh. She performed in a play, in a big theater play for Ambassador Grady. He was the U.S. ambassador to Iran many moons ago, again, when things were much easier. Mm-hmm. And she, you know, the family's like, don't do it, don't do it. I think in those cultures, it's kind of, you know, looked down upon. Don't get in the arts. She has some interesting forays in it, but long story short, I always say that my parents are like a bad sitcom. My dad's like a sloppy scientist, and my mom was an obsessive compulsive artist. So it's just like, you know, the two of them together is just like, I guess what comes out of it is me. So yeah, that's basically the story.
Okay, well now, I know that your dad just celebrated a birthday, and tell us about his scientific work, because I read about it.
Oh, my dad's very smart. I probably should sit down and write about my dad, because everybody always asks me about his longevity and his story and all that. My dad's very accomplished. He, like your daughter, can I mention your daughter?
Yes.
He, like your daughter, is a Fulbrighter. Was a Fulbrighter, and just a very, very smart guy. He worked on the Apollo 11 mission. He mm-hmm. just is very into science. I think the way that I'm into, like, acting and drama and comedy and entertainment is like, you know, the way my dad is about science. He's obsessed with science. To this day, he still reads the science magazines. He's in all these mathematical societies. So it's really cute and cool, and that's basically my dad. So
okay, and you went to college where?
I went to University of Maryland. Having a Persian father and a Persian background, he really wanted me to be a scientist. I went to math and science camp every single freaking summer. But I was like, you know what? I really like the arts. And he's like, you don't want to do engineering. You don't want to do science. Why don't you study economics? I have a friend at the World Bank. They don't pay a certain kind of tax. It's true. I don't know what tax it is that they don't pay, but he's very practical. You know, he's a man of numbers, so that's what his thing was. So I was like, okay. So I study economics. I minor in theater and journalism, and I spend all my time in the theater and journalism buildings. So that was that. After school, I got a few grants working on Capitol Hill as a journalist and a researcher, and a lot of it was like Iran-related stuff, being that, you know, I mean, I was born and raised here, but the cultural thing. So a lot of that was very interesting. It was an interesting time to be on Capitol Hill, and it was fun, and I did like it, but I have to say I love the entertainment journalism. Don't you? Isn't it fun?
Yeah, I do.
It's so much fun. I love the entertainment journalism, and then I had some forays in Persian TV, and my show's on hiatus right now, and I love covering these events, and I think it kind of turns you into, how do I say this? It kind of makes you not really aggressive, but it makes you more of a go-getter.
Yeah.
Because I don't know about you, Dawna, but I'm always at the end of the red carpet in between, like, the poor man's Telemundo, which is Azteca, under a bush or a tree or a shrub. And then there's, like, a big light, or there's, like, a pole of some sort. And on the other side is, like, not a fancy Korean TV station, but, like, a mom-and-pop operation with the son monitoring the camera, and the daughter is, like, the reporter. So I think when you're in those kinds of conditions, it really makes you be a go-getter, and you really got to reach the microphone.
Yeah, so. And you have to be aggressive, you know,
yeah.
And you have to get around the people who keep asking the same question over and over, because the people will go around you.
Yeah, you have to do your research, and then they'll be like, wow, lady at the end, you really know what you're talking about. And you're like, what can I do? So it's been an experience. I think it really forms you as a reporter, having to do that. I think it's really paying your dues, don't you?
Yeah. And what's the name of your show?
You know, I'm on Gem TV, and it's called USA Reporter, because they have reporters from all over the world. They have a branch in Dubai, Malaysia. So yeah, I'm their USA Reporter lady. But again, that's on hiatus. I don't know when that's going to come back. So we'll see. But it was a fun experience. I've gotten to interview such interesting characters, which I'm sure you've interviewed as well, right?
Well, Yeah, red carpets, you know, you meet a lot of really interesting people and you network a lot. Okay, so you've been a reporter, you've been a TV interviewer. How did you get into acting? Wait, you're a comedian too.
I'm more of a sketch improviser. I did stand up and it just wasn't my thing. There's amazing Middle Eastern and Persian, especially Persian stand-ups, and I've interviewed pretty much all of them, but I'm more of an improviser sketch person. I think improvising is really helpful. Improvisation, I think it's great for voiceover. I think it's great as a journalist, don't you? Because you're often on the spot and you don't have much time. You got to be fast on your feet. So I like to think of myself as more of an improviser. I studied improv at Upright Citizens Brigade in Hollywood, UCB. Mm-hmm. And one of the founders is Amy Poehler. I've never met Amy Poehler, but if I ever do, I'll be like, wow, your UCB was very helpful. And what we studied there was the Herald, which is a long form of improv. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a make it or break it of improv, because usually improv at like places like Second City and Groundlings, it's game based or it's character based. But at UCB, you're on, because you have to do like a Herald. It's like a series of sketches, and then you kind of have to relate it. It all has to go in relation at the end. Like, you could be like a news reporter, you could be like a family scene, you could have all these scenes, but it all has to relate and it all has to tie in at the end. So it could be really good, or it could be 45 minutes of pure torture. So that's basically my background in improv and comedy. And I was in some sketch groups in Hollywood, but it's very Darwinian.
Did you do it to further your craft then, or
definitely? And I think I have to say it was very good to have a sense of community. I think a lot of that has changed because everybody can go on the internet now. You can do Funny or Die videos, you can do sketches, which is wonderful in a way, but in a way it kind of keeps you from meeting other people and doing other things. And I mean, I've performed sketch with amazing people. A lot of these people that I've worked with actually are on series now. So there was always something to learn. There were some amazing people to work with. But yeah, it was definitely for the practice, getting out there. I think there's nothing like doing theater. But unfortunately, in Los Angeles, people don't come out to see theater much.
I think it's more the equity waiver one. So you do it. You do it if you really like the play.
Yes.
And I mean, it's really interesting. You do have a lot of equity waiver theaters. You have South Coast Repertory out here.
It's very prestigious.
But they're also very hard to get into. Like, we've got one in Orange County. So. Okay, so have you done theater out here?
I have, actually, off the Brookhurst exit. I used to do theater at Second Stage. Have you heard of Second Stage?
Off the Brookhurst exit. I've heard of it.
Yeah. That's where I got my start in theater, actually. Ironically, was in Orange County, and it was, isn't that weird? So I did theater in Orange County, sketch comedy in Orange County. I had a great theater director. His name was Chris Berube. He has the Berubians in Hollywood. And then I did shows with them in Hollywood. And then I did shows all around. Like, I never was at Second City, but I did shows there. I did shows at, did I do IOS? I did a show at UCB. I've done shows at different places. There was a place called The Empty Stage, and the guy who ran it was amazing, Stan Wells. He's in Seattle now. But that was an amazing experience, because I think people in the Pacific Northwest and places like that, they have a different form of improv. And everybody's got a different tempo. And I think that's so important as an improviser. And I think the improv helps with the voiceovers that I've done, because you kind of have to be fast on your feet, especially when I've done stuff in Farsi, because it's not my native language. I've done a lot of things here and there. And I think it's kind of good, because you get a diverse background of things, and it really helps you in training. I mean, you could take scene study classes till your face turns blue, which is great as to start and to do, but I think it's great to do different things as well.
Okay, now I know that you're on series as well, so how did you get started in acting?
How did I get started in acting? I think it was through the theater and doing the sketch and the improv. I did a few plays in college, but I was mostly behind the scenes. Actually, I did hair and makeup, and I'm not really that good on hair and makeup. And like, I think I'd help with like the set and the blocking and this and that. So I did a lot of that in college. We had an experimental theater at University of Maryland, the Black Box Theater. I did a little in back home, but there really wasn't many opportunities in D.C. I think it's mostly industrials. I think especially after 9/11, there's probably more opportunities. But I feel like, and it's probably like any aspect of the business, they have the people that have been there for like 30, 40 years doing all the industrials. It's the same group of people that they have over and over and over again. So I feel like it was harder to break in stuff back home than it was here. Because like, I remember me and the other folks from University of Maryland, like as soon as we got out, we're like, wow, this is really tough. And I think when you're in the Mid-Atlantic, people go all over. They drive for hours and hours on end, because it's not like Hollywood, LA, where everything is in one place.
Yeah.
You would go state to state wherever you could get work. So it was very very compelling. I find that when I was back east, I did a lot more journalism-wise. But acting-wise, I don't know. I just started out here. I think I did.
Did you move here for the acting?
Pretty much, and for the journalism. I feel like if you're in Washington, well, back when I was in Washington, unless you want to be a lawyer or like work for a think tank or a government agency, or you want to be a diplomat or something, that's pretty much it. It's weird because people come from all over the world to be here, to be, you know, in acting and music and all that. But I feel like a lot of people come to Washington in a reverse way to be into politics. Oh, okay. So it's a very transient, in a way it's very different, but in a way it's kind of similar because everybody's coming out for something. Mm-hmm. And I think the big thing in Washington, people would say, oh, are you on the House side? Are you on the Senate side? People are very, very political, and I think it's probably the same. Are you comedic? Are you dramatic? Different, but it's the same. But yeah, that's basically my start. I did a lot of indie films. I did a lot of shorts. I did a lot of theater. And then since then, I've just been progressing into more and more stuff. I'm a character actress, which I kind of like. Initially, I wanted to be like the roomy leading lady, like
you
Foxy
are.
Mama, like you, Foxy Mama. But I like the character stuff, and I'll tell you why. Because when I started doing horror movies, like I would be like the neighbor lady or usually the friend of the girl, and they'd be like, I think it's like a conveyor belt of young women. These girls would only last for so long, and they would be in the stuff, and they were the leading lady, and they were like the grand dame of the movie, and there'd be like me with my couple of lines. But you know, I'm still around doing my couple of lines. Who knows what? I mean, I wish them the best, but don't you feel like it's a conveyor belt with the ingenue type ladies?
Tell me, you just got a series, right?
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting thing that happened. I was kind of taking a break from things for a while, having an old dad, and I got an audition for the Mindy Kaling pilot, and I love Mindy Kaling. I'm a big fan of her work. She's on The Office, but not just as an actress. She wrote a really funny book called Why Is Everyone Hanging Out Without Me? And I was one of the first people that bought the book. I love her blog. She's a obsessive shopper. And I guess when I got the role, I went to set, I was so excited because this girl knows how to dress. She has the Christian Louboutin shoes. She has the Hervé Légère dresses. You would love her because she's quite a fashionista. But what I loved the most about working on that project was most of it was improvised. She's from a big improv background. She's from The Office. I mean, we had scenes and everything, but what I auditioned for was completely different from what I shot. So that was an interesting thing. I wasn't there for the table read, but the young man who played my son said, wow, a lot has changed in this. The table read. These people really like improv. So I think, again, it's a great skill to have the improv. But yeah, I'm working on the Mindy Kaling pilot. It's a small supporting role, but it was a lot of fun. And I'm a big fan of Mindy, so that was even more exciting. I think in between takes, because she's so busy, she's not just the actress, she's a producer, she's a writer, she's a showrunner. I didn't get to talk to her much, but I was admiring her clothes because the girl knows how to dress. And what I love about that show is she's not your typical leading lady. She's kind of a character actress. She's Indian. What I like about her, she's beautiful in a very approachable way. She's not like a Gwyneth Paltrow or whatever, you know what? So it was nice to see someone like her in TV. I think she's very inspiring for all women, especially minorities, to see a woman like her helming her own series. And I'm not just saying this because I'm on it. It's very funny. She's very, very funny. It's very, very good. The Mindy Kaling pilot on Fox. I'm very excited about that. But I'm very excited to be working with you on stuff. And I hope we get to work on more stuff together.
Oh, I hope so too. Well, okay, now, Mark Savage is an amazing filmmaker, and you're really good friends with him. How did you meet him?
It's a very funny story. I actually met Mark when I first came out here about 10 years or so ago, and I was at the Rainbow Room with friends, and it's funny, I met him through Ron Jeremy. I've never worked with Ron Jeremy. I'm not in the porn industry, but my friend Pat knew Ron Jeremy. We sat at their table, and Mark was at the table. I'm thinking, because, you know, Mark was at the table.
He's very clean cut and preppy looking. Is he like the...
conservative,
and he doesn't look like the type of person you would expect to make horror films. They're a very quirky bunch, and I say that as a compliment. He's like the boy next door, the Australian boy next door. Thinking, who is this person with Ron Jeremy? It turns out that Ron Jeremy acted in one of his movies, and it was one of the first big roles he had that wasn't pornographic. So he has a lot of respect for Mark. And it's funny, I used to live in the same neighborhood as Ron, and every time I'd see him, he'd ask about Mark. And I'm assuming it's because Mark's a cool guy, but also because he gave him a big shot. You know, it's a great role. He played a cop. There was no, like, innuendo about him being Ron Jeremy or anything. It was a straight role. He played a cop. That's it. bada bing, bada boom. Anyway, I really hit it off with Mark, but I would go back and forth back east, and it just never came to fruition to work with him. Mm-hmm. And he's busy doing his own thing. And then we just stayed in touch over the years, and basically things started coming up. He's working on Pond Scum, and he's like, you'd be great as a role of a wife. And I'm like, wow, I can't wait to do that. I think we're going to shoot that part sometime in September. Mm-hmm. And then he mentioned Circus of Dread, and I thought I was just going to be like a circus person or something.
But you did film Pond Scum already, parts of it, didn't you?
They filmed it, but my scenes haven't been filmed yet.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, my scenes haven't been filmed yet, but we're going to shoot the scenes in September. It's a small supporting role, so I don't think it'll probably be a couple days of that. But yeah, so he was telling me about Circus of Dread, and I'm like, I'll just be thrilled. And I was so grateful for Pond Scum, if it's like a small character role. And then it turned out to be a much bigger role. And I think, I don't want to give it away, but isn't the role based on his ex-wife or something? Or...
Oh, he didn't tell me that, but I know. I mean, I know the synopsis of the story, and it's your play Susan.
Yes.
So you have a huge part.
Surprised.
Yeah. And it's like Domi and Bill and you.
Yeah, I was astounded, thrilled, honored, and I'm a big fan of Domi's and Bill's, and mm-hmm. they're tremendous. They're tremendous people. They're tremendous actors, and I don't know. I'm just very excited about that. I'm excited about working with Mark, and I'm excited about working with you. And big thanks to Matt, our wonderful manager, for making mm-hmm. this happen and bringing this all to fruition. I feel like I'm around a bunch of really phenomenal people lately, and knock on wood, I'm excited. But yeah, Mark is such a character. You know, it's funny. Mark, like I said, he has a very sweet face. You know that one of his hobbies is getting Mexican murder magazines? The only place in America that sells them is some newsstand in Van Nuys, and I live in the valley, so he'll call me, he'll be like, I just got my murder magazines, and I'll be like, okay. And he's just such a character.
And you know, he's tall and thin and blonde and really good looking.
Yeah.
I mean, he told me that, like, he used to imagine himself as a monster when he was a kid. I can't imagine that. And he's got a degree in psychology. He's incredibly intelligent.
Yeah, he's a good-looking guy. He's like a Ken doll, but like on the inside there's like nothing Ken doll about him.
No, he's got a blog that is like what it's rated what?
I don't even know what it's rated. Does it even have a rating? It's like the Mexican murder magazine.
Yeah, it says you have to agree to something.
Yeah, lots of things, and then you click on it and you hope for the best. But I know it's harmless. But yeah. What is it? Phantom of Pulp is his blog. Uh-huh. But what I like about him is that he's so many different things. He can't even be like a metaphor for himself because he's so... but he loves like... unusual things, like just being his friend is exciting because he knows all the crazy places. He's like, let's go to the CIA place. It's this place in North Hollywood. I don't know if you've heard of it. We should shoot something in that CIA place. I think the guy that runs it used to have a funeral parlor. There's all sorts of weird things in there. And I think Mark finds the beauty in like very scary and frightening mm-hmm. things. And he's just such a character. And just knowing him, it's interesting because I've learned so much about horror from him, and he's got such an interesting viewpoint of things. I mean, regardless if I was working on his films or not, I'm a big fan of his work. I love Sensitive New Age Killer. I love all his stuff. And he's been making movies since he was a little boy, so there's a really dark quality to him, but you really don't see it. Like, I think it, like, when we went to the signing that you were at Dark Del, like, he really stood out because, let's face it, people in the horror community are quirky. Mm-hmm. They look a little dark, a little, you know, mysterious. And he's like the boy next door.
He's also taller than everyone else.
Very tall. And he just really stands out. And I think it's great because it's like people really don't expect that out of him. And he's just such an interesting character. I think we're going to have so much fun on the set with him.
It's going to be wonderful.
Yeah,
like
with
Domi and Bill. I just can't wait. So, and I'm so excited to meet you because I've heard so much about you from Mark.
I've heard great things about you from Mark and from Matt, our manager as well. And
yeah, Matt Chasen is our manager.
Matt, the wonderful and amazing Matt Chasen. So yeah, it's just been a great experience. I feel like since I've started working with Matt and these projects with Mark and you guys, and just meeting Bill was such a pleasure. Domi mm-hmm. was such a pleasure. I love how you guys are so humble and you're so accomplished and you're so great at so many things. And it's so inspiring for me to see and to work with you guys. I think it's exciting and I'm excited. But I also do voiceover as well. I've voiced a lot of industrials. I've done stuff for Fidelity. I've done a lot of stuff for the Persian Market. And I'm working on a film right now. It's an animated film called Lovesick Fool. And I voiced two roles. It's like a romantic comedy, like a lovable loser kind of comedy. It's by the Emmy-nominated director of The Simpsons, King of the Hill, and Family Guy, Dominic Polsino. And he's a very talented guy. And he is just amazing. It's funny because Lisa Kudrow from Friends is voicing a role, Janine Garofalo, and Fred Willard, who's very controversial lately. But I didn't get to meet them because I was in the booth on different days. But it was very well done, and I don't know when that's going to come out soon. It's probably going to hit the festival circuit, but that was a lot of fun as well.
Well, that's really high profile then. What's the website for it?
I think it's lovesickfool.com. I'm not sure. But originally it was a short, and he's turning it into a feature, so they're kind of fixing things around. But he's very clever, this Dominic guy, and I think one of the highlights for me in voiceover was being directed by him, because when you're in the booth, directed by the guy that did these amazing, iconic shows, he makes you really good. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think I'm okay in voiceover. I don't want to be that actor that thinks I'm the best or whatever, but I think I'm good. But he makes you, like, really, really good. Like, you know, you could feel like Macy's and he'll turn you into Nordstrom's or Henry Bendel's. It's just, I hate to be such a girl about it, but it was such an experience. And there's so many colors and layers to it. And he is just phenomenal. So working with him was a great experience. I'm very excited about that.
Oh, okay. Well, I know you're a great actress too, because Mark says that.
Oh.
Now, you do so many different things. Let me ask you, what do you like the best? Or can you pick one?
You know, sometimes I feel like I like one thing more than the other. I think it depends on the project and who I'm working with. It's funny because I had a very small role. I don't even think it would qualify as a line, in a film called Shireen in Love, and it was an ensemble movie. It was like my big fat Greek wedding, but for Persians.
Uh-huh.
And the guy that directed it, Rami Niami, I'm a big fan of his. He's done some great films, indie films in the past, and it was like a star-studded cast of like Middle Eastern talent. Maz Jobrani was in it. All these great Persian comics and actors. This actress Nazanin Bonyadi is in it. Working actors, Marshall Manesh, I think he's been a cab driver in like every TV show and movie. he was in it. Maximini is a great comic. Sam Golzari, it's like an all-star Middle Eastern cast with Amy Madigan, who's Oscar-nominated actress, George Wallace. And I had one line, and I have to tell you, I think I was more excited than everybody because I was so starstruck with all the actors there.
Okay.
And it was the first time I worked on a really, really, really big ensemble movie. So even though it was a small independent movie, it was like a full Middle Eastern ensemble cast, and I thought that was very empowering. And it's funny, they shot in the same house as the house they used for The House of Sand and Fog. So there was like a whole history behind and I'm like, why does this look so familiar? And they were like, this is the house that was for The House of Sand and Fog. And I was like, wow!
Oh, Sheree. Yes. How do you say her last name?
Sheree Akdashlu.
Yeah, she won the Emmy for that, because I covered it that year.
She won the Oscar nomination for that film, and she won the Emmy for House of Saddam. And I've interviewed her a few times. She's quite lovely.
Yeah, she's
lovely. Yeah.
Okay, so when did you do this film?
That was done last summer. It should be coming out in the fall. But that was, even though I had a one line, but it was a fun bit with Maz, who's like internationally renowned comic, Maz Jobrani. So that was a lot of fun.
I can't wait to. Was Iyad in it? Iyad Hajjaj?
Or
Saeed?
No, it was a Persian cast, but I'm sure if it was a complete Middle Eastern cast, those characters would have definitely. And I adore them. They're fabulous, Iyad and Saeed. But I hope to work with them, and I'm excited that you work with them, right?
I can't wait to work with Iyad. He's great. And we're going to see Saeed, too, in when Lawrence Raw comes out. And you would be perfect for that movie, so I'll tell you about that.
Thank you. Oh, shucks. Why, thank you. I'm just excited to be working with you. So it's just been an incredible experience. But I think, Dawna, the thing for people like us to do is to do our own projects.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm starting to get into that slowly but surely. I produced a short, and I want to start doing more of that stuff. So, you know, I'm slow to start, but I think that's really the wave of the future, and I think it's very important to do that. And I also think it's very important to have mentors. I've had a great mentor in voiceover, and his name is Doug Rye, and he was just phenomenal. I had another great mentor, Ivy Bethune. She's a 92-year-old character actress, the Ivy Bethune.
Oh, yeah. I covered that when George Takei won.
Ooh, so you went to the place downtown. What's that theater?
It was the East-West Theater.
Yeah, it's East-West Players. Yeah. She's a remarkable woman. We were in a voiceover workout group together, and I learned so much from her. So I think it's great to surround yourself with mentors, and I think it's great to do your own projects.
What was the name of your project?
Next Life Crisis. It hasn't hit the festival circuit yet. I did it with these great actors, Todd Huntington, and it was phenomenal. And Herbert Russell, they're great actors, and our writer, Zach Van Eck, it was just a wonderful experience. Russ Sindit was our DP, mm-hmm. and it was just fabulous. I really enjoyed it.
Okay, so we're family now. We're all in we're in Matt Chasen's group. So thank you very much for this interview, and I'll be interviewing you again when it's closer to the time when we film Circus of Dread.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dawna. It was an honor to be interviewed by lovely you. I had a great time. Thanks so much. It was a real pleasure. Thank you.
Hey, Mom. Can I watch Kill Bill? Maggie loaned me the DVD.
What happened to Beauty and the Beast?
That's a kid's movie.
She's smart. She could learn a lot from this film.
Like?
Revenge is a dish best served cold.
Great. I was hoping my daughter wouldn't turn into the bitter woman scorned for another 30 years. Okay, you can watch the movie, but after we eat. I don't want to puke during dinner. Eric? Eric, wake up!
What the fuck are you doing?
I should ask you. This place is disgusting.
It's a good thing you don't live here.
Forget about her, okay? We'll just make our own plans. Yeah, officer. You left the group early and didn't see anything, okay?
Yeah, okay. Who's gonna believe that stupid shit?
Well, let's fucking make it official.
Let's fucking make it official?
Yeah.
Mind his own fucking business. Like I was hurting you. I'm just having a little fun, you know.
Come on, baby. Let's just relax. Don't worry about
it. Well, you got your milk bone. Now I ain't broke neither. Look at this real gold. Damn, where's the other one? Did you take it, bitch?
Take what?
The other gold coin.
I didn't take it.
You liar.
سلام بینندگان عزیز. من ویدای غفاری هستم برای USA Reporter Gem TV. پس بریم ببینیم. شما امشب مثل همه شبا خیلی بامزه هستید.
مرسی. شما هم ماشاءالله خیلی خوشگل و ماشاءالله تیستتون تو کامیدی خیلی خوبه.
سلام بینندگان عزیز. من ویدای غفاری هستم برای جم تیوی. امروز اومدیم برای پریمیر هودوینگ 2 در سینمای گروو که تو مرز وست هالیوود هست. بهترین سینما هست در بهترین مال برای بهترین مووی. ما اینجا هستیم با هنرمندترین ورزشکار ایرانی حامد حدادی که فکر کنم قد بلندترین در ایرانی دنیا هستیم چون من روی این وایسادم روی نیمکت وایسادم هنوزم قدم از شما کوتاه
من عرض سلام دارم خدمت شما و خیلی خوشحالم که توی برنامه بودم من قد بلندترین نیستم یکی هستش بلندتر از منه تو ایران جابر اسمش ولی خب من
اونو دیدین تا حالا اون شما
آره همتیم دوست خوبم هم هستش
خب مثل شما بسکتبال
پلیر باز میکنه
خیلی روزا جالبی بود خیلی صحنه های قشنگی دیدیم رفتیم اسبای قشنگ دیدیم که مال ایران هستن دایناسور دیدیم چیزای خیلی جالبی دیدیم در LA County Fair تا دفعه دیگه من ویدای غفاری جم تیوی USA Reporter
Vida Ghaffari for Gem TV. We're here at the beautiful Greystone Mansion for the event called the Concours d'Elegance. It's a rare classic auto show held on the beautiful grounds of the Greystone Mansion in the hills of Beverly Hills. It's a great event, great cars. You'll see the beautiful mansion and grounds here. Really looking forward to this event. Let's go check it out, shall we?
What's it like to be in this amazing movie with your amazing self in it?
It's... What's the word? Amazing!
You're very funny. We're here with the lovely Sinead Grimes. I love your little black heart.
Thank you. It represents the social movement that I started called Spread the Heart to raise awareness and relief for Japan.
Wonderful. Yeah. And I have to say, I'm very impressed with your work on 90210, but I am like dating myself. I love the original Degrassi.
Thank you.
I'm very excited. I am excited. I'm just happy to be out of the house. You know, I'm looking forward to it.
It must bring back fond memories of everybody loves the radio.
It really does. It really does. I love most of these people, but two.
It was a great day at the beautiful Getty Center. We saw priceless works of art by Van Gogh, Degas, John Singer Sargent. It was just an amazing, amazing day. We saw beautiful, priceless sculptures, the beautiful gardens of the Getty Center. Until next time, this is Vida Ghaffari for Gem TV.
Hi.
Hi.
I want to be an extremely talented actress that works incredibly hard but never seems to catch a break, but does catch herpes, gonorrhea, and syphilis, gets toxic shock from a bad boob job, skin cancer from excessive boob tanning, while battling anorexia, bulimia, and alien hand syndrome, has 5 kids from 5 different fathers, and gets beaten to a pulp by her abusive strip club bouncer girlfriend, and dies alone in a rat-infested motel in San Pietro. Her dreams shattered and her life a complete waste.
I think I can help.
Go fuck him and calm his prissy ass down.
I just have to fucking say that I'm not a part of this either. You're on your own.
Well, go stop him. That's the least you can do for me.
Fuck off, all right? I'll just do it.